Welcome back to Useful Idiots. I'm Matt Taibbi.
And I'm Katie Halper.
And the holidays are, they're kind of over, right? We still have one more to go.
Well, let's see. By the time you're watching this, it will be New Year's Eve.
And we have Russian Christmas after that. So that's an important date for all of us, obviously.
That. Do you celebrate that with Putin? Are you going to be on a Zoom with Putin?
I'm going to be in his lap. Nuzzling him.
But in.
In his lap.
I will be in the lap of Putin. And father's lap.
Right. Yeah. All right. So we're going to have a really interesting show. We have a really interesting guest who's going through a hellacious situation right now. And Mark Crispin Miller, professor at New York University, who's going through just yet another one of these. An expedited like canceling episode that just kind of hits all the worst notes of these things. And we got some news to catch up with because we've been gone for 2 weeks now.
Sorry, guys.
So why don't we just hit that quickly? Let's do the four food groups. Republicans suck, Democrats suck. Isn't that terrible? Isn't that weird? You're up first, right?
Yeah.
Democrats suck?
Yes, I am. So let's go for Democrats suck. So if we could just play this video, shout out to Catherine Rose Fisher. By the way, my name is Catherine Rose. We can talk about that another time, whose handle is K Rose F. And she tweeted out, Senate Democratic Whip Sen Durbin is on the floor right now opposing Bernie Sanders' call to hold up the NDAA to get a stimulus increase. Let's just watch the video.
They came up with a good bill, one I was proud to support. This annual legislation has been signed into law for six consecutive decades. When the Senate fails to do anything, they always do the National Defense Authorization Bill. It shows that Congress can come together, at least on this measure, when it comes to supporting our men and women in uniform and keeping our country safe. This year, the bill authorizes $740.5 billion in defense spending. It provides another 3% well-deserved pay raise for our troops. It also recognizes that many in the armed forces are on the front lines here at home as well, helping fight the ongoing COVID-19 epidemic, providing our troops with necessary benefits and protections, including a 10% increase in hazardous duty pay. The bill also includes a number of provisions that I authored and supported, including language expressing strong support for the Baltic states and Ukraine, especially in the face of continued, unforgivable Russian aggression. It requires the renaming of military bases in the United States, which were once named in honor of Confederate generals, those who served in the Confederacy in an attempt to secede from the Union and to defend the institution of slavery, have been enshrined in the names of these bases for many, many years. This effort to rename them is long, long overdue. It tries to correct and recognize the mistakes of our past and really address the sensitive racial inequities at the Pentagon when it comes to this decision making.
So we got, let's see what we have there. The Russians, imperial wokeness or woke imperialism, right? So it's good. Look, and I'm fine with, I think renaming is long overdue. I'm not sure that we need to pit renaming monuments against giving people $2,000. I'm not sure Americans think that one should be sexual.
We should build a monument to that.
To what?
To not giving people $2,000.
Yeah, we should build a monument to, we should, instead of like Robert E. Lee, it should just be a statue of a negative sign and 2,000.
Like the general, you got shit.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like with
general 600 is over the top.
Right.
But, and then, yeah, the Russia stuff, glad we're supporting Ukraine. That's really important, definitely.
It's really important for us to ratchet up tensions in the Baltic states.
I know. It's so great. And, you know, of course, it was so great to do it when Trump was president also, which I just, again, just pick a narrative. Cheeto Mussolini, you want him to ratchet things up with Putin? Okay. Oh, making the Pentagon more divert, more representative.
Right, yes, yes.
Because you want, when you are bombing black and brown people, it's a lot better to have someone black or brown at the helm of
It has to look like a Benetton commercial.
Yeah.
in the control room. In fact, they should be wearing Benetton clothes. Frankly.
In fact, Benetton should be sponsoring this.
They should. Yeah. In fact, they are.
Yeah, they are. Yeah. We have it on good authority.
That was product placement.
Yeah. Yeah, Benetton, we're open to that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just like disgusting. And really, the Democrats are not on board with this. This is like, who is it, Bernie and Markey?
Right.
Is Markey? Yes. Like, why is this controversial?
Well, look, and should we just flow into mine? Because it goes straight into the same thing. So my Republicans suck. McConnell blocks Democrats' attempt to quickly approve $2,000 stimulus checks amid pressure on GOP to act, right? And so, I mean, I think we see a theme developing here,
as the kind of economist finance guy, can you explain what Sanders was proposing or trying to do?
Yeah, he was blocking the National Defense Authorization Act, right? So, which never gets blocked,
right?
That's why everybody's mad at him, because it's bad form.
Except the people who are grateful to him.
Right.
Who are not political and media elites.
So, but I think everybody should notice a little bit of a pattern here, which is that all the people who have something politically at stake, right? Now you see down in this Washington Post story, you'll see that both of the Georgia Republican candidates, David Perdue and Kelly Loeffler, they're for the $2,000 checks.
Yeah.
Trump is suddenly for it. And Chuck Schumer, the same Chuck Schumer, who not long ago put Mark Warner and Joe Manchin in charge of coming up with the bipartisan deal that didn't have the $2,000 checks. Now he's upset at Mitch McConnell for opposing a $2,000 check, saying it's a blatant attempt to deprive Americans of a $2,000 survival check. Right. So it's a hot potato game.
It was also that when Manchin and Warner were opposing it.
Of course. Like this is just, you know, Bernie's sincere about this. I think we can say with some confidence that he actually wants people to get the $2,000 checks. But this is the way basically Washington works, which is that there'll be a certain number of people who'll be who get to be in favor of the populist thing, but there's always going to be enough Mitch McConnells and at critical moments Chuck Schumer's and Nancy Pelosi's to make sure that certain things just don't get passed, right? And Dick Durbin's, right? And Durbin, if you remember correctly, he was one of the people he was one of the first people to express a willingness to pass a COVID relief bill that didn't include state and local aid or the $2,000 checks. So it's
with
just
Democrats like these.
Right, exactly. And it's like, okay, so Mitch McConnell's a Grinch, right? And he's always the bad guy in basically every narrative, and he is. He sucks. He's horrible. But it's just
he is a stain on turtles.
Right. But it's just interesting the way that when it finally comes time to vote, As Durbin puts it, magically they never seem to have problems getting that $740 billion defense bill passed.
Yeah, and it's also like it's so out of touch. I mean, I guess in a way it's like a useful or logical strategic thing to do because there is so much like rah-rah imperialism in this country, or quote-unquote patriotism. But there is also fatigue. Like I think people more and more are getting sick of the idea of spending more money fighting wars than doing
absolutely
here.
And on both sides of the aisle.
Yeah,
I mean, like that was a big talking point for Trump in 2016, right? Which is that we got to spend more money you know building bridges at home. I mean, he didn't do it, but
rhetorical commitment that he did not do. But it's like, doesn't he get that that's kind of a, I mean, he's just kind of showing and not just telling the situation. Like, there is bipartisan consensus for around funding the military-industrial complex and not bipartisan consensus around helping people survive.
Specifically people. Like, there is a bipartisan consensus for a massive open-ended Fed-fueled bond buying program, right? Yes. You know, because who could possibly dispute the wisdom of making sure that, you know, all of our national treasure is committed to propping up the financial markets, and not even all the essential ones, like junk bonds included. Like, but the significant chunk of people who are looking at eviction and who are going to food banks right now, like, it's an emergency. I mean, I don't know. I'm not an expert. I don't know what the best course of action is, but it's just so glaring that some people seem more concerned about that than others, that I don't know.
And the argument that, you know, what I love also, that speaking of bipartisan consensus, you have Fox News anchors saying this, which is that people are, you know, have more money to spend. They can't go out to bars or restaurants. So they're just like stuck, you know, they're just hoarding bills and cash, and they're probably burning it right now and, you know, smoking cigars and everything as they do that. Because all working class has turned into a bunch of fat cats. Thanks to the pandemic. But then you have Larry Summers.
Yeah. And do you want to talk about this? We can talk about this.
We can do a little interruption of the four basic food groups, leave you in suspense, and then go back to those.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, look, Larry Summers, the former Clinton Treasury Secretary, the former Barack Obama's former head of the National Economic Council, former chief economist at the World Bank, former president of Harvard.
Friend
of Jeffrey Epstein's. Just sort of a famously unattractive, villainous personality who has said some pretty amazing things in his career, including that the underpopulated countries of Africa are vastly underpolluted. And
he's done some terrible things, right? Like, in terms of deregulation, and didn't he have a role?
Yes, he was involved in the repeal of Glass-Steagall, the sort of hyper concentration of the banking industry that allowed Citigroup to form, and then he was ignored all the warnings about derivatives, that came from people like Brooksley Bourne at the CFTC. So he's sort of a zealot of the financial crisis, right? And then he took a ton of money from the banks before rejoining the Obama administration and helping guide the bailout policy. So he came out with this thing in response to the Bernie thing. He went on TV the day before Christmas. And basically what he said is, anytime you see Bernie Sanders and Josh Hawley agreeing about something, you know it's got to be wrong. So he's working backwards from that assumption, which is awesome to begin with, right? And then he went through like a litany of all the reasons why $2,000 checks to individual people are, and essentially what he says is that overall household income as a percentage of the economy's potential is significantly higher than it was before. Now, that sounds confusing to a lot of people, but essentially what they're saying is the reality is that there is a big chunk of people whose income hasn't been affected by the pandemic, but they have less stuff to spend it on. They're not going to restaurants, right? They're not doing all kinds of things. So they have all this cash that's not doing a whole lot, right? And so I guess if you aggregate out everything, you could, I guess, make the argument that dumping more cash into the population is not needed, right? Which is what he's arguing.
Yeah, he warns that it will overheat the economy, which is funny.
Which is hilarious, because when they did the, you know, gazillion dollar bailouts in 2008 that had no limits, and they did quantitative easing, which was another trillions more dollars, which was, and they did the CARES Act last year, which is trillions more dollars, and they were pumping money into the economy. Nobody was worrying about inflation.
Right. Where was he there? Was he warning against overheating then?
Right. But if you're giving money to individual people, who just happened to need it, right?
Right.
As opposed to whatever it is. And so, then suddenly we got to worry about inflation.
And he even had the gall to say, I'm not even that enthusiastic about the $600.
Right. Yes, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And look, there are people who agree with him. I mean, there are economists out there who will say, oh, well, this isn't the best way to do it. We should have targeted this or that. There should be more means testing or whatever.
No, good.
It's fine. Good. Whatever. It's just that this guy, he's a symbol of this kind of person who has no issue with spending any amount of money,
right,
taxpayer, Fed, or otherwise, when it's the military, a bailout.
Right.
Shouldn't he
be banned from polite society?
I don't know.
He should not be an authority.
Yeah, just for his whole role in the Facebook thing, I think he should be.
What was that?
You ever see the social network? Yeah. So when the Winklevoss twins went to complain that Mark Zuckerberg had ripped them off, Larry Summers was basically like, "What's your problem? Come up with another idea."
Oh, right. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, he didn't kind of get that this was actually a real.
Right. But, he has no. He's so out of touch and. I mean, it makes sense. The guy didn't get into trouble for any of this stuff. So why would he ever think he had to be at all? He doesn't even have to pander. He doesn't even have to pretend to care.
It's just guys like Summers and Bob Rubin and Michael Froman and Jason Furman and all these economists who are always around this Biden, Clinton, whatever, like that wing of the Democratic Party. It's been so long since they've had to interact with actual people that this all makes sense to them, you know?
Yeah, and ironically, Hillary Clinton warned about this, remember? Or admitted this in the Goldman Sachs tape, I think.
Right,
you know,
yes.
Worried that we're getting out of touch, which is like probably the most in touch thing she ever said.
Well, I always thought that was funny because she was so much more like accessible and warm and in that talk with Goldman than she was.
Right.
Anyway, the Summers thing is hilarious. It's just a classic example of kind of American aristocrats and how they don't know how they sound, you know.
Also, as a Jew, I'd really like him to stop doing that. And that whole group you named, they do not represent us. We would like to draft them, kick them out, and they are not the faces. Well, they are, but they're not representative.
All right. So returning to the four food groups, what do we have for...
Isn't that terrible? It is possible to overdose on candy, at least if you're eating black licorice. That's because it contains a compound known to be toxic in large doses. In an extreme case of this happening, a man in Massachusetts died after eating too much black licorice.
Huh.
The 54-year-old man suddenly lost consciousness after experiencing a life-threatening heart rhythm problem, according to a report of the case published September 23rd in the New England Journal of Medicine. But that's okay. We're doing a retrospective of 2020. His family said the man had a poor diet, and in recent weeks, he had consumed 1 to 2 large packages of black licorice every day. Despite receiving multiple treatings in the intensive care unit, the man died 32 hours after arriving at the hospital. It does
death by licorice.
This death by licorice. It does death by 1,000 licor eye.
Right. I like it.
It does contain a compound called glycyrrhizin, derived from licorice root. It can be dangerous because it lowers the body's potassium levels. And this in turn can lead to high blood pressure and abnormal heart rhythms. And the FDA says eating just 2 ounces of black licorice a day for 2 weeks can cause heart rhythm problems, particularly for people ages 40 and over. So this is not just an isn't that terrible, but it's kind of a cautionary tale.
Mm-hmm.
Because I didn't know that. And, you know, my dad really likes licorice, so I'm gonna have to tell him.
Hmm.
I feel like that didn't really land for you.
No, it did. I mean, look, I love stories about medical oddities.
Right.
And used to be a big fan of a writer named Bertrand Ruisher. He used to write medical mystery stories that came from real life. And one of the key plots in a lot of his stories is just don't eat a lot of the same thing.
Okay.
You know, yeah. Like if you eat too many carrots, you're going to get carrotinitis and you're going to turn orange or whatever
orange,
it is,
right. Yeah.
Or red or whatever it is.
I'm going to
guess if you eat too much of anything to the exclusion of anything else, of other things, that it's going to be bad for you.
Right.
Well, I don't have anything to match. All I got is a video from a character who's appeared on our show before.
Yeah.
Dan, if we could see this headline, isn't that weird? The headline in the story reads, Boston Dynamics robots are dancing now, and yes, it's still scary. So I think most people know Boston Dynamics are like, they're sort of a YouTube phenomenon because they have these kind of horrifying looking robots that they keep releasing videos of doing things like walking through the wilderness in Massachusetts or anyway, they are really like PR conscious and they're always trying to like go viral with their videos and they've done it again. Damn, if we could watch this video, it's pretty good because they use a hit from the early 60s. All right. Okay, it goes on. And needless to say, great work. But Dan, if we can go back to that story, I had exactly the same reaction as like most of the people on Twitter that they cited. Here we go. At Cody Co writes, totally personally looking forward to getting killed by one of these and then having it do the crank that dance on my body. This is what they'll do when they'll win. Oh, look, someone taught robots how to dance in our graves. So, yeah, I mean, my first reaction when I saw that video was that I just was imagining them, you know, doing that as they were pulling my larynx out in some, you know, policing situation. But anyway, isn't that weird?
That is weird. That's creepy.
It's creepy.
That's creepy, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I am kind of divided on the whole Boston Dynamics thing because the machines are kind of awesome.
I don't like the dog.
You don't like the dog?
It looks like a dinosaur. Its tail looks like the head of a dinosaur.
It would freak me out.
It would freak me out. I mean, so would the people. I guess the whole thing is robot apologia, though.
Right. I mean, theoretically, they're using it for like, oh my God, there's somebody like stuck up in a mountain. He has to be saved. So let's go send.
But through dance, through the art of dance.
Let's send our dancing robot up the face of the Alps to go, you know, tirelessly walk you down, you know, the slopes. But I just don't see it that way. I mean, I know that's how I'm supposed to think of it, but
right. Well, that's good. That means you're skeptical.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're a skeptic.
Which incidentally is the subject of our discussion with our guest.
Yeah.
Today, who we might as well introduce.
Might
Professor,
as well.
Mark Crispin Miller, from New York University, he's just in some shit right now. I mean,
yeah.
First of all, we should preface, Mark became pretty well known in media circles during the Bush years. He wrote a book that I love called The Bush Dyslexicon, which was a pretty hilarious chronicling of the unintentional comedy of everything that George Bush said. His reputation is absolutely as... until recently was absolutely right. As like a, you know, blue friendly liberal Democrat.
Yeah. He pushed back. Well, I think a little more to the left than that. Right. But definitely friendly to Dems in his,
right.
Documenting Bushisms, like the Bush Dyslexicon, and also documenting, what he said was, voter theft.
In 2000, 2004.
Yeah.
So, but he has aroused some critics with his views on masks and electoral fraud and some other things and got in
right.
trouble in his class for suggesting that somebody read some alternative research about masks. Now, there are people who are going to react emotionally to that, but when you actually listen to what he has to say, it's more about the whole issue of, are we allowed to seek out other sources
right.
of information and what happens when we do. And this is a pretty scary story. So,
yeah. And I actually think that there's an interesting discussion to be had about tenure. And, you know, the thing that he's being accused of, which he did not do, is of telling his students to violate NYU's mask policy. Right. That's I think that's a kind of interesting, trickier case. To me, this is not that tricky.
My take on this is that they, when there are efforts to censor people, they never come out and say, we really want to censor you.
Right.
What they say is, oh, well, we have to do, this isn't censorship. This is just being concerned about public health, or this is a national security issue. I mean, look, right. If you look at the Facebook, Twitter, Google, like what have they cracked down on? They've cracked down on information that they say could lead to people deciding not to vote or not having confidence in elections.
Yeah, that's totally obscene and absurd.
Right, but they always present it as, well, it's not a speech issue. This is health. This is security. This is all these other things. But it, you know, ultimately it is. And the tenure issue, let's be frank, they're trying to create a new conception of what tenure is in America, which is much more highly conditional than it used to be.
Just in case people are wondering about the origins of tenure, reading at AAUP, the modern conception of tenure in U.S. higher education originated with the 1940 Statement of Principles on Academic Freedom and Tenure. And it gained the endorsement, jointly formulated and endorsed by the AAUP and the Association of American Colleges and Universities. The 1940 statement has gained the endorsement of more than 250 scholarly and higher education organizations. It is widely adopted into faculty handbooks and collective bargaining agreements at institutions of higher education throughout the United States.
Basically, it's designed to make you bulletproof in terms of, you know, you can't be fired for stuff you say.
Right.
Or really for almost any other reason. But the boundaries of this are being eaten away at. And this is, this story seems to be one of a sort of a classic example. So without further ado, let's talk to Mark Crispin. Welcome to Useful Idiots. Thanks for coming on.
My pleasure, and thanks for having me. I'm grateful for this.
For folks who don't know, you're in the middle of what sounds like a classically horrible academic dispute. Could you give us the outlines a little bit of what you're dealing with at the moment?
Yeah, I'll try to make this as clear and succinct as possible. I've been teaching at NYU since 1997, and it's media studies is my field, basically. And one of the courses I've taught every year, every semester, really, and sometimes even more than that, is a course on propaganda. It's always fully enrolled, waitlisted, very popular with students. Now, this is where the trouble started this particular semester. Although there were a few things that happened earlier in the year that should have told me something was up, but what happened was I began the course, as I always do, by making clear that my approach to the subject of propaganda is not to treat it as some ancient thing where we look at the Nazis, we look at the Bolsheviks, maybe we talk about World War I, maybe we talk about McCarthyism, right? We definitely look at those earlier examples, but the focus of the course, the mission of the course, is to try to teach students how to recognize it in real time, make an effort to assess its claims impartially, even if you agree with them, and then see if you can discern the hallmarks of a propaganda drive, because it always comes disguised as news or entertainment or something like that. Figure out who's behind it and what its purpose is. And I make this abundantly clear, it is a difficult thing to do, intellectually difficult. It can even be socially and psychologically difficult to be skeptical to that degree, right? So I said, as I always do, you know, we would naturally focus on some of the things that are going on now. For example, look at the way we're meeting. I mean, we're meeting via Zoom. This is eloquent testimony to the success of the whole COVID crisis propaganda. And propaganda does not have to be
false, right?
Pejorative.
nefarious, as you said.
No.
Something I mean, read, yeah.
A campaign to get you to wear your seatbelts in a car, that's propaganda. But propaganda it is anyway, and so we would want to deal with it. For example, we might want to look at the mask mandates. I would encourage you to look at a body of very interesting scientific studies, 8 randomized controlled studies conducted over the last 15 years or so among healthcare professionals of the effectiveness of masks against respiratory viruses. Because the consensus of those studies, and those are the most rigorous kind of scientific study, randomized controlled studies, the consensus is that they're not really effective. I would encourage you to read those. I'll send you the links. I also think you should read more recent studies finding otherwise. And I gave some guidance as to how a layperson can assess the soundness of scientific studies, because I mean, I'm not a scientist, right? And they're not scientists, most of them. I said, for example, there are scientific reviews of these studies. You can find them. In some cases, there's actual press coverage of very public objections to studies. And you'll want to look at the universities where these studies were done and see if they have financial arrangements with big pharma companies or get money from the Gates Foundation, because this might suggest some kind of conflict of interest. Okay, I said all this. Mm-hmm. I also said, I said pointedly, I am not telling you not to wear masks. Okay, NYU has a strict rule. I observe the rule. This is an intellectual exercise, or would be if you did it.
Right.
Okay. All right. So that happened. And then the following week, or maybe a little later, a student emailed me and asked to join late. And I, as I always do, I said, sure, you know, more the merrier. And she joined us. And the second day she was there, she had spoken up at one point the first day about Edward Bernays's book, Propaganda, which we were discussing. The next day, the mask thing came up again. So that little bit resumed. And she didn't say anything. That was on a Thursday. And then early the next week, I get a call from my department chair asking me in a kind of accusatory tone. I think he asked me if I had discouraged them from wearing masks. Or did I have them read something that suggested they don't work? And I, whatever he asked me, I said, well, this is what I said. This is what happened. And he said, oh, well, I'm going to have to tell the dean's COVID task force, whatever it's called. I said, okay, what's up? And he told me that a student had gone on Twitter and demanded that I be fired. Okay. It's the first I'd heard of this. And the first time anything like this has ever happened, of course, a class like this will get students bristling. You know, it'll get students disagreeing. I always say throughout the semester, do not believe a single word I say. I'm not an oracle, okay? I'm not doing propaganda here. I'm trying to teach you how to do your own research and make up your own minds. So if I say anything that strikes you as outrageous or crazy, or I never thought of that before, just look into it, okay? Look into it. If you find that I'm wrong, then let me know and I'll correct myself, but that's what the course is about. It's completely open, okay? She didn't do that. She just went online and not just one tweet, but a whole stream of tweets demanding I be fired. I'm putting the students at risk. She took screenshots from my website, News from Underground, as I send stuff out to a big listserv every day, all kinds of information on many subjects, and it's always stuff that people should know and we don't know because the media has blacked it out and or misreported, et cetera. She, you know, put up all these screenshots and like they were self-evidently false, and she said they were from right-wing and conspiracy sites. Okay. That was
And this is 2020. You have to take any kind of call for your job seriously on Twitter, right?
Well, sure, sure. So I was of course not happy about this attack, but what really troubled me, shocked me, was that my chair tweeted his thanks and said, "We as a department have made this a priority and are discussing next steps." Okay. This took my breath away. We as a department, I'm in the department. I've been in the department for 23 years. Nobody asked me anything.
Yeah, which we? Yeah.
Right. So then the next day, the dean and the doctor who advises NYU on its really draconian COVID rules, which have led to lawsuits and so on, emailed my other students without putting me on copy, basically saying that I had given, first there was a ritual nod to academic freedom, which they all do. So we respect academic freedom, but hinting strongly that I'd given them really dangerous misinformation and providing links to what they said were authoritative studies from the CDC. Studies which I also had urged them to read, and not pointing out in his email that the CDC itself had echoed the consensus of those studies until early April, and then it abruptly pivoted. And the WHO did the same thing, World Health Organization. They pivoted.
Not the band.
Sorry?
Not the band, but the World Health Organization.
Unfortunately, not the band, right? The World Health Organization.
That would have carried maybe a little bit less import, yeah.
Yeah,
right. Well, it would have been better to dance to, anyway. So they said that, you know, you got to read these, basically saying, these are the truth, read these, which is the opposite of what I do.
Right.
And then they ended by warning them that they have to wear their masks, as if I had told them not to. All right. So that was the second punch. And the third punch came when my chair basically pressed me to cancel the propaganda course for next semester on the grounds that my film course, as I often teach that too, a film course, is so heavily enrolled that if I were to do two sections of that instead of the two courses, it would be really good for the department's numbers. And I can relate to that argument. The problem with it is that both courses have the same limit, 24 students. I usually have 26 or 27. So that was just a pretext. All right. So all this happened. And it prompted me and some friends to draft a petition simply urging NYU to respect my academic freedom. But this is crucial, not just on my own behalf, okay? This petition on change.org is really on behalf of all professors, journalists, activists, scientists, doctors, whistleblowers, anyone who has been gagged or punished for their dissidence on many subjects, something that's actually been going on since the 60s, since the Kennedy assassination, when any inquiry into the truth of the Warren Report was nailed as conspiracy theory. And it would be a career killer for a professor to dig, or a journalist to dig into that. And that just got worse over the decades.
Gulf of Tonkin, any of those things.
Yeah, right. But Bobby's assassination, King's assassination, then there's 9/11, then there's all this other stuff. And now, since this COVID crisis started, it's off the charts bracket that, and I'll get back to it, because there's an interesting point to make about all this. The petition, which was garnering tens of thousands of signatures, and to date it has like 25,000, and it includes some very, very eminent people. It incensed my colleagues, my department colleagues, or most of them, about 25 of them, prompting them a month after the student demanded my head to send a letter to the dean demanding what they called an expedited review of my conduct, not just because of what I'd said about masks, which they said I had intimidated students who were wearing masks and discouraged them from wearing them, which was typical of the letter, but far worse than that, because of my egregious brutality in the classroom and my crackpot views. Okay, this is stunning reading to see myself accused of, and I'm quoting now, explicit hate speech, attacks on students and others in our community.
What was your hate speech supposed to be?
Can we defer sure. that? Because mm-hmm. I can answer that, but it had nothing to do with anything I've said in class, but they said I engaged in explicit hate speech in class. Attacks on students, advocating for an unsafe learning environment, aggressions and microaggressions. You know, every sin in the social justice hymnal was invoked to cast me as this alt-right brute, this bigot, which was just so false as to seem insane, you know? Well, they asked for this review, and the way I heard about this letter was the dean emailed me and said, I've ordered this review of your conduct because of this letter, which I hadn't even known about, and there it was. So I was gobsmacked by this. I mean, I thought I was friends with some of these people. I've known them for a very long time. I asked the provost what to do, and she said, ask for a meeting with the dean. So I had one, this kind of meeting, you know. And he's very vague. He said the lawyers at NYU had instructed him and the provost that they had to do the review, which is actually not true. And so he was doing it.
So you have tenure, don't you?
Yeah.
Isn't the whole point of it to prevent exactly this situation?
Yeah, thank you. tenure was instituted to protect faculty who might be teaching on popular, taboo subjects or taking an unpopular position.
I believe it was.
Yeah, I believe it was in the during the Red Scare after World War One. I think it was in response to that. I could be wrong. But that's why we have tenure. You know, we don't have tenure because we're so brilliant. We have the right to make a living pursuing our research. We have tenure to protect our free speech. So, yeah, I have it. And it would be a tough sell for them to fire me over this. But that is the intention here. Because my colleagues made it clear that, they respect academic freedom. Don't get them wrong. But when someone's conduct is as egregious as mine, it nullifies academic freedom, according to the NYU faculty handbook. That was their argument. So they're trying to get me fired.
So they're basically trying to create like tenure with an asterisk, basically,
well,
right?
Yeah. Yes. Yes.
And. Mark, it can't possibly be that they don't understand the concept of, in propaganda, we try to read everything, right? Like, it can't possibly be an actual understanding issue. This must be, have something else to do. I mean, it must be some other kind of bureaucratic dispute. Do you suspect that there are views that you've held previously that they disagree with, or that other people in your department disagree with, or that your dean disagrees with, and that this has become a pretext? And if so, what might those things be?
Well, that's a big question, and I'll try to answer it, because it's an excellent question and an important one. First of all, I think my colleagues are sincerely outraged by some of my views, or what they think my views are. Now, see, if they were in my class, I could actually engage them in a conversation about some of the things they think I said. One of the things they claim in their letter is that I have denied, on my website, I've denied Sandy Hook happened. Okay. MarkCrispinMiller.com, anyone can go there and do a search on Sandy Hook, and they'll see that it doesn't come up once. I don't mention it. What they're referring to, and what incensed them, apparently, as the fact that in a propaganda class, I think it was after some group reports, I have them do reports in groups on school shootings and how they've been covered and so on. After that discussion, someone mentioned Sandy Hook, which was the first in the series of school shootings that have, been so high profile in this last decade. Columbine was much earlier, and that was very different. I said, you know, there is some very interesting research on Sandy Hook that is troubling and very challenging. And I dismissed it out of hand till I read it, and I have to say there's something to it. And so if you're interested in this, you might read it. And I mentioned this book, a collection of essays. That was my denying that Sandy Hook happened. So clearly a student in the class reacted in precisely the way I urged them to try not to act in the class. Just heard me say that about Sandy Hook. Maybe had some other grievance against me and went and told some of my colleagues that he's denied Sandy Hook occurred. And then they all said, see, typical, he's denied Sandy. They say in their letter that I promote non-evidence-based claims, which in a letter filled with non-evidence-based claims is pretty rich, you know. But so that, you know, that's an example of what I take to be their sincere discomfiture with my engaging precisely the sort of subject that most academics and journalists and others are sort of trained to avoid, because you get in trouble if you talk about them. But the whole course, as your question implies, Matt, the whole course is sort of about that. You know, we can always easily spot the propaganda that we don't agree with. You ask any liberal, what's propaganda? They'll say, oh, Fox right. News. You ask any conservative, what's propaganda? They'll say MSNBC. Okay, they're both right. You know, both are propagandistic. But what they can't see is the propaganda that they agree with, because they think it's just information. They think it's just the truth. So there's that. Now, your larger question is what is going on here, right? Why did NYU's lawyers advise the dean he had to do this, when we know for a fact that there are no grounds for doing this, no legal grounds? And I say this on the basis of a really terrific letter that FIRE, Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, a great nonprofit in Philadelphia, they sent a long detailed letter, which I sent you, to NYU's president, Andrew Hamilton, laying out all the grounds, all the reasons why there are no grounds for this review, which is illegitimate, and urging him to step in and quash it, a request that he has ignored. He has done nothing, said nothing. And so one must ask, how did all this happen and why? I mean, here's a student who took to Twitter, but it took off like wildfire. Was all over the place. I heard from all kinds of people I hadn't heard from in years, like concerned about me. And there were three media attacks on me, one in Gothamist, one on City and State, which called me one of the losers of the week, biggest losers of the week. And then there was some student publication. They all attacked me without interviewing me. And what is this, organic? Did this just happen spontaneously? My experience with her in the classroom tells me that her reaction was sincere, but it is quite possible that when she flipped out, she may have spoken to colleagues who then took advantage of this, because their letter is kind of an amplification of her charges. They're very similar. They also accused me of having attacked her and of deliberately naming her and publicizing her contact information so that she...
Doxing her, right?
So that she was now subject to cyberbullying. This is a media studies department. I assume they know what Twitter is. I mean, when you tweet something, your contact information is right there. I didn't name her anywhere. The only place where her name comes up is in my petition, which necessarily includes her tweets, to tell the story. But I have never sent out any emails or done anything, posted anything with her name in it or her contact information. I would never do that. But again, this is clearly a concerted campaign to do me in. And the question then again is why? And I will say, I'm unable to answer that question. I will say that I have been a thorn in the sort of corporate side of NYU for years. They initiated a horrendous real estate expansion plan for Greenwich Village called NYU 2031 around 2012 without consulting any faculty. And I spearheaded a major effort to resist this, organize the faculty, big faculty alliance. We got 39 schools and departments to issue statements condemning the plan or urging it to be reconsidered, including the Stern Business School and the Department of Economics with its four Nobelists. We got a lot of publicity. We got celebrity support. We had an op-ed in the Times. It was very successful. And I think it did succeed in sort of limiting the plan to the one monstrosity they're building now on Mercer Street. We sued the city over it too for approving it. So that didn't endear me to the Board of Trustees, certainly. And I'm a named plaintiff in a class action suit over NYU's mismanagement of faculty retirement funds. So I'm kind of, you could say I'm sort of a whistleblower or troublemaker. But I the last thing I'll say about this is that's sort of ancient history. I think that what's happening now, if there is a connection to the university, which I suppose we'll discover because I am suing the people who signed the letter, not the junior faculty. I'm not suing them because I don't believe whether they were willing signatories or not, they really had any choice. So I'm suing the 19 others. And only them. We'll see if some connection turns up, but if there is one such connection, I think it would have more to do with the fact that since, say, April, I've been extremely active in circulating a lot of information about COVID, its origins, possible remedies, stuff about the vaccine that's in the works, stuff about whether asymptomatic cases are even infectious at all. This is scientific stuff, a lot of it. And I've become, oddly, a lone academic voice providing this kind of information to a public audience, as well as, you know, encouraging my students to do the same kind of work, you know, to cast a wide net as I do publicly. And NYU is very, very heavily invested in the vaccine industry, in the military and the medical industrial complex, I should say. And they're very, very deeply invested in the whole COVID narrative, masking and so on. I think that the idea that someone like me would be on their faculty is probably odious to them, or could be, so that if there is a university connection, if this is not just cancel culture run amok at the academic grassroots level, I think it would have more to do with that, with my heresy on this subject, than on those earlier sins of mine against the corporation.
It's funny. It's almost like, well, a couple of things just occurred to me. One is that you're not, I guess you're not the crackpot conspiracy theorist that people allege, given that you're not jumping on what could easily be a justifiable response to the student. Like you just said that she was, not that you're on trial here, not that we're replicating the Inquisition, but you said you actually thought she was sincere. And I do think that's how a lot of things happen. You have like sincere people, then you have people with an agenda, and then there's a combination. And I like that you were, I heard you on Red Scare, and I like that you were gave a shout out to Gallatin, which is the interdisciplinary, I guess, department at NYU. But the other thing is, like, in a way you couldn't have like asked for a better demonstration of your course, right? Like they are showing what you're telling.
Oh, that is so true. This is the most amazing and painful teaching moment of my career, right? As we say, teaching moment.
Right.
Yeah, they've just basically proven the truth of everything I've said, that I always warn my class, you know, if you do this in earnest, you make an effort to move out of your comfort zone, okay? I don't care what your politics are. And look into these things, you will end up coming to realizations that you're going to have trouble sharing with some people. I mean, not always. You know, some kids have very cool parents and friends who are just interested. I mean, one of my students this semester says in his letter, in my defense, that his whole family has been sitting around the computer listening to the class. I mean, this is like beyond gratifying for me. You know, the only upside to all this is that I've gotten such wonderful support and so much vivid testimony to my effectiveness as a teacher, which means the world to me. Mm. I mean, that's why I got into media studies in the first place. I didn't get a PhD in communications. My PhD is in English. I mean, I was a Shakespeare scholar and film. And I moved into this just out of public concern and an interest in having people understand media, and wrote mostly for magazines with wide readerships, you know.
Well, to that teaching moment, that's actually what I want to ask about, because, I mean, in a larger sense, isn't the whole academic world kind of struggling with this issue of whether the appropriate way to go about teaching kids is to encourage them to read everything and discover things for themselves, or to give them the right text and tell them to avoid the wrong text? Like, there's a school of thought that is very much in that other direction now, that's a little bit more censorious, that believes pretty strongly in, you know, some things are just incorrect and aren't worth reading. And whereas the traditional idea is that we read everything and, you know, even the things that are horrible.
Right, like Mein Kampf is a...
Right, exactly, right. And now I think there's a tendency to sort of say there's no worth in even learning for yourself about these things.
Oh, that's so absolutely true.
Right, so, I mean, is it possible that you've become kind of a symbol on that front a little bit as well?
Well, yeah, I certainly have. Calling it a school of thought, I think, is dignifying it, because it's not it's not thought at all. It's thoughtlessness, the school of thoughtlessness, you know, and it's not a school, therefore, because you're not teaching anybody anything except groupthink.
Right.
And that's what's happening. It's very oppressive. It's just like... It sounds hyperbolic, but it's like going to school during the Cultural Revolution or you know, after Gleichschaltung, which is the Nazis' term it's like streamlining. It's when they made all the cultural institutions, they Nazified them all, you know. So, of course, there was stuff you couldn't read. I mean, it would be a crime to read it or even bring it up. And it's kind of like that now. I mean, many of the people who've been attacked by their colleagues, as I have, tend to be toward the right, you know. I mean, Scott Atlas was attacked by the Stanford faculty for, you know, working under Trump on health policy. And Alan Dershowitz has been attacked by the Harvard faculty for his, you know, legal advice to that effort after the election. But so the right tends to focus on this problem of deplatforming and censorship. And because of the, you know, prevalence, the power of social justice ideology throughout academia, it does tend to be against people who've sinned against the social justice pieties, who tend to be conservatives, who take the most hits. But as my case shows, you don't have to be on the right to be attacked this way. I've heard from many people, professors at other schools, who've had their, you know, slings and arrows, have had those shots at them, risked getting fired. Some have been fired, and they're, you know, longtime left people. But left, you see, you both understand, I'm sure, that the left today is not the left. It's not your grandfather's left. It's not the left that I remember, you know, that I have long considered myself part of, you know, which is anti-war, you know, which is about rectifying grotesque income inequality, strengthening the working class, certainly civil rights. You know, there's a whole range of
gender equality.
all that, you know, yeah. Definitely. Those are, I see them as left issues. I mean, many of them are also libertarian issues. So what the left has now become is a pro-censorship army. They want censorship. So the left has changed immensely, and I think that I'm sort of a casualty of that.
I would say that something we talk about a lot is on this show is the acceptance of the more censorious tendency, which winds up being actually a quite right-wing reactionary thing. You know, which empowers like Facebook, right? You have people who think it's a good idea to give these corporations more power as if they're going to have, they're going to be noble and objective and protect the downtrodden. And the example I always give is that, you know, the people who are the biggest casualties of this, and these are people who the left purports to care about and does, I think, in large part, are, for instance, is Palestinian critics of Israel, which sounds a bit niche, but it really is true. They are at the forefront of this censorship. We saw, both Palestinian journalists and civilians just get their Facebook accounts deactivated.
Right.
There is groupthink on the left, and there is, if you talk about cancel culture, you're kind of accused of not caring about social justice or racial justice or economic justice. And then because there's this cancel culture of that discussion, there is an overrepresentation of right wing, of the right wing in that field, in that area. But that's not because it's incompatible with leftism. It's because there is this cancel culture that does exist. And I interviewed Chomsky for my other show. And, you know, he said the only thing that's new about cancel culture, he says it's been around for a while, is that now for like the first time, the left is embracing it.
Yeah. Well, I was pleased to see him support that statement.
All right.
Several people have sent him my petition, which he did not sign. I mean, which was disappointing because here's the guy who notoriously wrote the preface to Robert Faurisson's Holocaust denial book. Right. And I don't think I've engaged in anything like Holocaust denial. What you say about Palestinian activists is quite true. One of the things we deal with in the propaganda course, in fact, is Zionism. And I've had a lot of students write great papers, many of them Jewish, on Zionism and criticism of Israel as anti-Semitism, which is a very powerful propaganda meme. Interestingly, my colleagues, you may probably know about this, that a Palestinian activist named Laila Khaled was supposed to do a Zoom presentation, several Zoom presentations, and one was going to be at NYU. And Zoom was pressured into censoring the presentations, which is outrageous, all too typical. And I signed a petition protesting this, but I was struck by the fact that my department is extremely exercised over this and even drafted a special letter of protest over it. So in their, you know, remember how Chomsky talks about worthy and unworthy victims?
Yeah, right?
So she's a worthy victim of censorship. I'm an unworthy victim of censorship in as much as they're trying to censor me themselves, you know. There is this double standard, and you're quite right. There's an important point you make that has to be stressed. Is that this sector of the left, you know, whomever it includes, I mean, maybe it's the Bernie sector, you know, maybe it's the Hillary supporters. I mean, who knows? But broadly speaking, it's kind of the left liberal masses.
As a leftist, I want to send the liberals to the gulag.
Right. You know, they have essentially been weaponized in support of corporate objectives. You see, it's absolutely right to note that they and Facebook are on the same page, that they and Google are on the same page. You know, Google owns YouTube. YouTube has been taking down videos, canceling accounts all over the place, and burying references to, you know, what they call sites of misinformation. So if, I can no longer really tell my students to do their research by using Google. You know, for years you could say, you know, the counter narrative is just a click away. This is what makes younger people especially receptive to the other side of the story. And I always took great comfort from this and used it in my course. I can't do that anymore with Google, because Google, it's just outright propaganda. The first 4 or 5 pages of search results are all pushing the mainstream narrative. So that there's this weird kind of unity between the campus left, certainly, and other sectors of the left, on the one hand, and then corporate behemoths like those social media, so-called social media companies, and big pharma. And you've got
banks. Kind of, yeah.
What's that?
And banks also.
Banks. I mean, why would corporate universities like NYU be so adamant and militant in enforcing social justice ideology institutionally? You know, why do they hire still more bureaucrats to oversee this kind of policing? Why is there this sort of bureaucratic apparatus, and not just in universities, but in corporations and in the government? You know, that's very interesting. That's very telling.
Yeah, I call that woke washing.
I'm going to steal that. That's
yeah,
good.
Please do. Yeah. We saw this. I bring this example up all the time, but it's just so telling, which is you have Cedric Richmond, who Biden named to this previously non-existent office, and he was a congressman, and he has a bad record on energy issues. What he's really doing actually is creating, it's something called like Liaison of Public Engagement or something. He's actually creating something that's dedicated to reaching out to white Trump supporters or white conservatives, which is so interesting because, anyway, that's kind of a separate story. But the point is that when the Sunrise Movement, you know, dared to criticize that, his naming, Biden naming him, Jonathan Martin, this, you know, reporter at the New York Times, not an op-ed writer, but a reporter, tweeted that they were from the beginning going after the most influential black staffer, Biden's most influential black staffer, which was such a weaponization of identity politics. And of course, like the people most harmed, this is the big irony, the people most harmed by this are the victims of like environmental racism. I mean, climate stuff affects everyone, but it is just such a, even by their own kind of metrics, they're violating their alleged principles. And it's so frustrating and something we have to be vigilant about.
Oh, you're so, I couldn't agree more. I mean, I've noticed this, here we're, you know, the kind of social justice phraseology is now used to cast mandatory vaccination as an issue of fairness and equality, and black people should get these shots first, as well as older people, right? Speaking of eugenics, I mean, black people are rightly highly distrustful of official medical mandates because of a long, gruesome history of their exploitation and torture by medical authorities. I recommend Medical Apartheid by Harriet Washington. It's just a great history of all this. So they are naturally suspicious and rationally suspicious of an insufficiently tested vaccine with an mRNA technology that's never even been used on human subjects. It's been rushed to market. There is no knowing what kind of autoimmune response it could kick off or when, right? But it's cast as we must do the right thing by people of color and give them the shots first. Well, you know, when they were using black people in South Africa as guinea pigs, there were protests there, not covered in this country's press. Rightly, protest, and in Brazil, protests over the fact that here again, they're using black people as test subjects for a vaccine that's going to make people billions and billions of dollars. The thing, Katie, that you're describing really I think dates back to Obama, who was, you know, as our first black president, was free to front for five more wars over the two that his predecessors had started, and to, you know, serve the banks and, you know, rack up a really horrendous record on civil liberties, the worst of any modern president, much worse than Trump's. But you couldn't criticize him, because if you criticized him, you were a racist. Right. And I think Hillary was supposed to do the same thing by being our first female president. And I think that Kamala Harris, you know, once Biden finally collapses irrecoverably, will be used in the same way. You know, our first black female president, she'll be used to front for all this. I mean, I don't think it's going to work very well, because she's not that popular with anybody,
right,
including black people.
Including black voters, yeah. I think that, you know, you asked how people could fall for this stuff. And I guess I want to make a confession that when Obama was president, I really was someone who I was distracted by the racism towards him. And of course, what we could have done was, you know, walked and chewed gum at the same time, pointed it out, but not excused him from.
I also liked him personally.
What did you say?
I liked him personally.
Yeah, I found, I mean, now I actually hate, now I kind of hate him more than anyone else, since right. He decided to leave his, you know, mansion in Martha's Vineyard to block Bernie, block Keith Ellison, discourage the NBA from going on strike, and go like windsurfing with Richard Branson. But I did find him very appealing at the time. I have to admit that even this, I cried both times he won. Really inexcusable the second time. Give myself a bit of an out the first time. But I remember writing about a lot, like, and I was focused more on that, on the racism that he faced, which was true. But it was also like, you know, there was a lot of racism in the way the banks were bailed out and in the way that Geithner and Summers handled that. And the best line / the worst line of the Hillary campaign was that thing where she said, well, breaking up the banks and racism, no, which was like not what anyone was saying. And also there was a racialized policy.
Yeah. Well, listen, Katie, don't feel bad. I've had the same. I could tell similar stories. I'm not representing myself here as someone who's always been immune to that kind of appeal. Yeah. I mean, we're only human. I mean, I'm from Illinois, so I kind of had Obama's number, but I was still, you know, supporting him. I didn't vote for him. I haven't voted for a Democrat since 1992. But I thought, you know, this gets us into election theft, which is a big subject for me, but. I remember, I'll take it back even further to the Clintons, you know, when the Republicans were piling on Clinton over the Monica Lewinsky thing, I was, felt protective of him. You know, in other words, some politicians are blessed in their enemies.
Yes.
Obama was blessed in his enemies. And Clinton was blessed in his enemies. So he had all these sort of Christianist troglodytes and others, you know, attacking him on moralistic grounds. But many of the charges against the Clintons were actually completely true. And it wasn't until I read Partners in Power by Roger Morris, a liberal Democrat. I think it was in the 90s he wrote this book, that I realized, oh my God, you know, all these gates that they attached to the Clintons' names, you know, Travel Gate and all this. They're crooks, you know. His thesis is they came from a completely corrupt political culture in Little Rock, and they brought that to Washington and succeeded in basically worsening the corruption in Washington. But the fact is, we have all been played over the years through this sort of sideshow of partisan politics. You know, that there are a lot of people I know on the right, and not just on the right, who sincerely think that Trump is some up against the deep state and was going to drain the swamp. And I actually don't believe that. I don't think anyone can get to the level where they're allowed to run for president, however much of an insider they may appear, without having been sort of vetted already. The point is, this brings us back to the beginning of our conversation. It isn't just my students. We are all obliged to make some effort to withstand the emotional pull of propaganda that pushes our buttons, you know? Not our enemies' buttons, our buttons. And resist that pull and try to keep your head and think clearly about what's being offered to you and who's offering it and what kind of appeals they're using. And understand that there's a tremendous amount of contrary information and data that we are simply not getting in a country like this one at the moment with a press such as we have now. I mean, I've never seen anything like this, you know? I mean, I wrote for the Times. I wrote like 4 or 5 op-eds. I was always on NPR. I was tolerated, right, until I published my book on the theft of the 2004 election, Fooled Again, in 2005. And then I was rebranded as a conspiracy theorist.
Yeah.
And that's when that opened my eyes to a lot, because I studied how that meme evolved. You know, it was developed by the CIA. This is established fact, to discredit critics of the Warren Report in 1967. And, once you see the truth, you got to try to stick with it wherever it takes you, wherever the evidence takes you. I think that's the obligation of any professor, you know. I think that higher education should be enabling people to think for themselves and to keep an open mind. And sadly, tragically, a lot of my colleagues don't see it that way, you know.
Yeah, to that point, this is the last question I have for you, but I wanted to kind of wrap up with this. Getting back to your case, let's say that everything works out for you, that there's no action, there's no investigation, there's no, nothing bad happens to your job. It still ends up being a pretty powerful moment in terms of the message that it sends to other faculty and to kids who might be thinking about writing this or that in their papers. And can you talk a little bit about that phenomenon as well? Like, you know,
chilling effect.
Yeah. Like the chilling effect, because I hear that it's interesting. I used to hear that only from academics, and now I hear that constantly from newsrooms, right? Like that's a thing that I'm hearing all the time from journalists now, which is that, man, I'm not even thinking about pitching this story anymore, right? Because I just don't want to deal with what's going to come back if I talk about this, which is just as bad as being told you can't write about it, right?
Oh, that's absolutely true. That's been in play for decades, of course. I mean, in order to rise within the world of journalism, as in academia,
sure,
you have to develop an instinct for what not to touch, you know. There's a great book.
I think that universe is just expanding a lot.
Exactly. It's expanding, and the pressure has become more explicit. The sort of brutality of the suppression is more clearly manifest. It's in our face more now. People feel much more vulnerable now. So yeah, I mean, if the purpose is to make me an example, they've already managed to do that pretty well. You know, I should add that I have a GoFundMe page where people can help me pay for my lawsuit. I am suing those colleagues out of principle, okay, beyond what they've done to me personally. And I mean, I have Lyme disease, the stress, believe me, I don't need, it's not been pleasant. So of course, on my own behalf, I want some kind of restitution, but this is a matter of principle. This kind of thing has got to stop, okay? Free speech and academic freedom are at serious risk of disappearing entirely, in which case we're not going to be living in a country even remotely comparable to the Democratic Republic that is ideally the form of government we're supposed to have, in which I think all right-thinking people believe. They believe in that ideal. You know, however short of it this country has fallen over the centuries. So this lawsuit is definitely a protest against what's happening to so many of us and through us to the whole society. So if people can you know, donate a little. I know these are tough times. The money's going to go directly into an escrow account that my lawyer will manage, because there's going to be depositions, and I expect it to be an arduous process. However it shakes out, Matt, it has served the purpose it was meant to serve. You know, speaking of Chomsky, I remember him referring to Vietnam as a demonstration model. You know, is it the demonstration effect that pulverized this country that dares to resist? You know, same with Syria, same with Venezuela, same in a way with Bolivia. It's a bit grandiose to compare myself with those, you know, horrendous historical episodes. But again, it's not just me, you know. It's anyone who has the temerity to dissent and to believe that the university should be a place where dissent is permitted, should be a safe space, you know, a phrase I use with an asterisk because it's itself kind of an oppressive phrase. I will say, too, that I'm going to release all the letters that have come in on my behalf. There's well over 50 of them by now. And one of the things the students say about my teaching, and this is relevant not so much to me as it is to those attacking me, is that my classes have been unusual in their experience precisely because I do not ever enforce any kind of orthodoxy, which they feel they're subject to in so many of their other classes, that there's a kind of, you know, social justice or liberal groupthink that you dare not contradict in any way. So a lot of students sit there silent and feel intimidated, bullied even, if they happen to speak up. And that doesn't happen in my classes. I don't allow that. You know, everyone is free to speak up. And that's what the fact that I even have to be sitting here saying this is just shocking to me. But that's what's become of us now, you know.
Do you have students who disagree with you in class?
Always.
Yeah.
I welcome that. I mean, I always have them disagree. Of course they disagree. Listen, just as I, like you, have fallen for, you know, various propaganda drives in the past, you know, so I, like them, have often bristled when people suggested certain things to me and thought that's ridiculous. That just can't be true. You know, that's crazy. It makes you kind of angry, which is interesting, you know, because often the thing you're being asked to consider strikes at something that's a part of your identity.
Yeah.
So naturally I have students who start vigorously shaking their heads and you know, objecting. And I'll say to them, you know, look, I hear you. Okay. But again, I'm not an oracle. So I urge you to look into this. If it matters so much to you, just do the reading. I mean, one of the letters, this is from maybe 15 years ago, a kid took my propaganda course. I had them read The Manufacture of Consent by Chomsky and Herman. And this kid was, you know, a believer in the nobility of American foreign policy. And it just made him mad. It just pissed him off. I said, look, okay, in this chapter, look at his sources, read the footnotes. Is he right or is he wrong? That's all we can determine. Is what he's saying true or false? I mean, there are ways to figure this out. And he found this to be a life-changing experience. He read the footnotes, the sources, and he realized, oh my God, you know, Chomsky's right, they're right about this. And he rethought everything. So yeah, disagreement is part of the educational process.
And have you changed your mind on things through debate and discussion with your students?
Yeah. Anything? Sure I have. I've changed my mind about many things. I mean, often people will adduce their own personal experience of something that I had not considered. The letters attest to my flexibility in that way. That's how you learn, you know. But I mean, often our professional training, whether it's J school or whether it's graduate school or medical school or law school, you know, it tends to kind of beat that out of us. You know, it tends to make us more certain and readier to support the status quo and not to do things that will challenge it, you know. And then that is further reinforced by the prospect of unemployment if you don't continue to do that, or the unavailability of funding. So the whole system is kind of corrupted, you know, by powerful interests, which is beyond worrying, right?
I just wanted to say, I guess, that I disagree with you on masks, but what's interesting is I was actually talking to a doctor about this, and he does too, but he also was adamant that, you know, that's not a fireable offense.
I hope
you
not.
Know, and it was, yeah, and he's someone who works in, like, you know, urgent care, critical care, and is a pulmonologist. And he actually, we should have him on, Matt, because he had some interesting things to say about, for him, it's kind of the downside of masks is so low. And his point is that also it's not that they protect individuals, so that Danish study isn't that relevant, he would say. It's that they protect others from individuals as opposed to the other way around.
Right.
But I do really want to say that something I think is extremely important, and you mentioned that you weren't being grandiose about this, and it's not just you, but the making certain things taboo and render and naming them conspiracy theories, that does have real life impact on the lives and deaths of people, especially when you look at something like Syria and Bolivia and Venezuela, which you mentioned, right? Like, right, the sanctions of those countries are killing people.
Yeah, no kidding.
And again, there is this thing, there's a tendency for, in some areas, there's a social justice within these borders, like there's a nationalistic social justice, and the racism and imperialism that occurs in other countries is kind of like overlooked. But I do think that's really important to remember, because when people are deemed crackpot conspiracy theorists for talking about Syria, for talking about, we've had on Aaron Maté, and he testified in front of the UN. Like, he's not, I don't think he's that much of a crackpot theorist if he's allowed to testify in front of the UN, but he's dismissed by most places. Luckily, The Nation publishes him. But that, again, that is a way of letting the U.S. government off the hook for impoverishing and really, like, killing people through sanctions.
Oh, absolutely. I'm good friends with Piers Robinson. You may know him, yeah, the British academic who runs this working group on Syria. And they have done amazing work exposing the lies about the Assad's chemical attacks on his own people, which is war propaganda.
Yeah.
And they've done a terrific job. And he has therefore been attacked as a conspiracy theorist. And they sometimes throw me in there too, because I'm on
Cy Hirsch.
Cy Hirsch is like a man without a country now. There's something called the Organization for Propaganda Studies, which Piers started in Britain, and I'm on the board with him. So that has given, you know, The Guardian and other gatekeeper media grounds for throwing us all into the hopper as dangerous conspiracy theorists. Yeah. Well, now, you know, now conspiracy theory is being cast, and it has been for a few years now, as not harmless, but actually dangerous.
Right.
This started when that kid Edgar Madison Welch went into the Comet Pizza place and fired a rifle into the ceiling. And it was all immediately covered in screaming headlines that this guy was a Pizzagate conspiracy theorist. See what happens. And the same thing just happened in Nashville. That explosion, which is extremely bizarre, said to be the work of this 5G conspiracy theorist, right? So what we're being told is something that David Cameron said 5 years ago publicly: conspiracy theorists are more dangerous than terrorists. He actually said that. And François Hollande proposed legislation in France to criminalize conspiracy theory, right? Now, this is all kind of morphing into the idea that misinformation on the COVID vaccination or masks is putting people's lives at risk, is threatening grandma's life, you see. And that gets us down to the essential historical fact that we're now living in a moment which is simply the culmination of the history of modern propaganda. It starts with World War I, really. That campaign against Germany was a masterpiece of emotional manipulation through fear and anger, that people were terrified and outraged by the Huns' horrendous atrocities against the Belgian people, impaling babies on bayonets, cutting off the breasts of nurses, you know, crucifying a Canadian soldier. None of these things happened, completely made up, but they succeeded in making millions livid in the UK and here in this country. They all signed up, they went to fight. My grandpa was one of them, got wounded in the arm. That had a very powerful effect, and it has never really changed. It is that playbook, making people fear that they are under attack, so that anyone who demurs or dissents is posing a mortal threat to them, okay? That's what it was throughout the Red Scare. The communists, they're attacking us, they're undermining us. The war on terror, right, after 9/11. So I'm deeply grateful for his point and yours, which is that just discussing this cannot be grounds for termination. Because if it is, we're not living in a free society. We're living in a kind of cult.
All right, Mark, thank you so much for coming on. Really appreciate it. And, you know, we're going to keep an eye on this, and good luck with this, seeing this through, and hope it all works out. And, you know, let us know if and when there's a resolution, and we'll be sure to publicize.
Well, I have to say, I enjoyed the hell out of this with both of you guys. It was just a great conversation.
Likewise. Absolutely.
And, great.
I will keep you posted. And I thank you for having me on.
All right. Thanks so much, Mark. Appreciate it. Have a good afternoon.
Bye-bye.
You know what I like about that? I mean, look, it's a horrible story, and it's kind of a part of a theme of stuff that we've been talking about a lot for a year or so. You know, he teaches a course in propaganda.
I know.
And in America, when you're taught propaganda, they always teach you, okay, it's Nazi Germany, it's the Soviets, it's whatever. But American propaganda is so much better, and they don't
more nuanced and
they
subtle.
Don't come in and like red pencil stuff. They call you crazy, or they come up with some other formulation. And look, he might be wrong about all sorts of things, right?
Yeah.
But the core idea that conspiracy theories are more dangerous than terrorists, which is like a rising belief now, you know, it's a thing. Right? I mean, I think this is like kind of a canary in the coal mine kind of a story, frankly.
And I think that also, you know, the thing that really bothers me about the way that the weaponization of conspiracy theories. No, sorry. What would that be? The toxifying, is that a word? Making something toxic? Can we make that into a thing? The toxifying of alleged conspiracy theorists is that it really sanctions other theories, right? So like, you are a 9/11 truther, right? And I don't agree with that. I don't think that they make a convincing case. But the fact that makes you a crackpot while believing that there were WMDs in Iraq doesn't make you problematic. It makes you MSNBC material. That's right. Really like there's a real inherent like value judgment that is not at all like principled or consistent. And also there are conspiracies that happen. Like
conspiracy just means conspire means breathe together. Right. So the things that, you know, banks do with, you know, the Senate, they're open conspiracies, right? So the conspiracies are all the time. The problem is what we're living through this weird period where they're trying to like almost criminalize things that we used to just ignore. Like I love the scene in Men in Black. You ever seen where Tommy Lee Jones and Will Smith, they're desperate to find out the like what actually happened, and they go, well, we got to go to the news, and they go to the Weekly World News, and that's where the actual real information
is.
Well, there's like a grain of truth to that, where like if you look in the corners of like sort of fringe media and, you know, people who've been laughed at or whatever, like you'll often find stuff that, you know, maybe it's not put the right way or it's researched, you know, sloppily or whatever, but there's like things in there that have been kind of closed out of conventional wisdom that are really, really worthwhile, you know, and what they're trying to do is shut the door on all that.
Yeah.
And that is freaky.
And the ick factor that you write about.
Yeah, totally. Right. And he's a classic example of that. Yeah. Right. You know,
and also the, what were you just saying? Conspiracy theory. Oh, and the other thing that is similar to this in some ways is the right wingification of things. So like, it is, I think it's an outrage that Tucker Carlson entertains the serious stuff and MSNBC and CNN don't. But instead what people say is that is clearly a fringe right wing conspiracy theory because Tucker Carlson and Laura Ingraham are the only people who talk about it. No, the outrage is that no one else does.
Right. Yeah. Tucker Carlson does like a series on the impact of private equity and hedge funds on small town America. And all of a sudden it's like, well, that's a right wing trope. Like, no, it's just should be on 60 Minutes.
Right. Exactly.
But it's not for whatever reason.
And I saw, you know, a lot, there's this talking point. We see Mark Warner said it and Larry Summers, all praise be upon him, said it, which is, you know, why is Bernie working on something with Hawley? Like, clearly, if you're working with Josh Hawley, it's a bad idea. And again, no, the point is, it's a shame that the right, and honestly, if you're a leftist or even a liberal, you should be wanting the left to carve that out more than they are. And you shouldn't be leaving it. You shouldn't be giving Republicans the chance to stake that territory.
Right.
But again, it's this guilt by association, false equivalency. It's really awful. And it's not looking at things on the merit. It's just looking at, it's like circumstantial evidence.
Yeah. I mean, it just, America, for all of its faults, used to be a really great place for crackpots and people who had weird ideas and weird beliefs and experimented with all kinds of odd stuff and started alternative communities. And
you know,
some of them were completely nuts, right? And that was fine. That's part of our history.
Yeah.
But they're trying to phase that out. They're trying to take that part of our, our culture away, which is really unfortunate.
Our cultural legacy. And the Clinton example is so important because there really was a vast right-wing conspiracy. And
they suck.
There are real things that they did. And they are so lucky that they had those insane right-wingers attacking them, because they use that as a shield all the time. And they, you know what the vast right-wing conspiracy was? Apparently, part of it was Monica Lewinsky. No, that was real.
Anyway, that was great. That was really fun. Well, not fun. It was interesting and kind of scary, but
laughed, I cried, roller coaster of emotions.
Yeah, exactly. And thanks for listening in. And we will, thanks for tuning back into us after the holiday. Hope you had a
good
day.
Yes, thank you for,
we'll see
you missed us. Hope you missed us. I'm sure you did. Rate and review us. Subscribe to us on YouTube. And shout out to our producer, Dan Halperin, and Sheer Mag, the band that does our theme song. Lots of people are asking about that, so wanted to put that out there.
Excellent. Yep. All right. Thanks. See you next week.
Thanks.